It's me, that is Alex. Let's play the mind, shall we? Blow Up is a 1966 movie by Michelangelo Antonioni, starring David Hemmings and with music by Herbie Hancock. It's about a photographer who realizes that a series of pictures he's taken in a park actually conceal a crime in progress in the background, and the only way he can figure out what that crime was is by zooming into the pictures. That's when he faces a technical problem. The more he enlarges the photographs, the less he can clearly make out what they hide. Because of grain. In chemical photography, film grain or granularity is the random pattern of speckles that give a granite-like texture to a picture. It's a side effect of the lighting conditions and the size of the light-sensitive crystals on the film. Silver salt crystals, approximately 1 micrometer in width, the average size of bacteria. The counterpart of film grain in digital photography is image noise, caused by random electronic fluctuations in the camera's light sensor. And the closer you look at a picture, the more you can perceive its granularity. The trade-off then is to look at a picture from a certain distance. Even the sharpest human eye can't tell 2 speckles apart if the angular distance separating them is below 1 arc minute. That's 1/60th of a degree. Picture this. If 2 of your friends stand shoulder to shoulder on the north end of Central Park, and you look at them from all across the south end, your eyes simply won't distinguish them from one another. Your friends will essentially become one unified blob of friendliness. But your best friend is your brain. It has a way of threading together all the choppy information it receives from your senses, and it makes some sense out of the world around you. For instance, the part inside the human ear that's sensitive to sound is actually made up of bits and pieces that are optimized to pick up only certain frequencies. Yet, when you hear a wailing police siren, you hear it as one uninterrupted sound which rises and falls in pitch. The organ of Corti is a narrow strip of tissue inside each ear, and it contains approximately 15,000 hair cells nestled in the basilar membrane. Their function is to send nerve impulses to the brain whenever a section of the basilar membrane vibrates, and depending on the frequencies that make up the sound that's heard, different sections of the membrane are set into motion. Think of the organ of Corti as a series of thousands of wine glasses, each one sensitive to a frequency ranging from 20 to 20,000 Hz, which is the average range of human hearing. And when some frequencies are heard, some of the wine glasses resonate.
Mom, I broke it!
You did not.
33 millimeters, that's the length of the organ of Corti. However, it doesn't lie straight inside the ear, but rather neatly curled up into a snail-shaped structure called the cochlea. That's right, the cochlea. Sounds enter the ear, make the eardrum vibrate, get transmitted through the ossicles into the fluid within the cochlea, which in turn makes the basilar membrane vibrate. Pretty much all of the hair cells get affected to a certain degree by any sound produced, but it's the brain's job to figure out what frequencies are heard by filtering out the weaker signals from the strongest ones. Ears not make one great. The force of the brain does. This whole hearing mechanism isn't specific to humans. In fact, all mammals have similar hearing mechanisms. But when looking at other animal families, things can look quite alien in comparison. In birds, the cochlea is actually uncurled and obviously shorter given the average size of a bird head. In insects, we find 4 completely different ways of picking up sound, such as drum skin structures on their legs or antennas specialized in hearing ultrasounds from bats. And in fish, it's the inertia of a stone inside the ear that allows hearing as the whole body of the fish vibrates when sound is picked up. Ultimately, what matters is for sound to travel from source to receiver through some sort of medium. Sound through air travels at around 330 meters per second. Through seawater, the speed of sound is about 1,500 meters per second. And through diamond, the speed of sound shoots up to 12,000 meters per second. The Newton-Laplace equation is a common formula used to calculate the speed of sound through different materials. Rho is the density of the material, and Ks is its resistance to compression. The higher the density, the slower the speed, since the atoms and molecules are either heavier to move around, or there's more of them per unit of distance. And the more resistant to compression a material is, the higher the speed. Which is logical because the more a material is like rubber instead of crystal, the more time the sound waves are wasting to compress the material instead of just traveling straight through. But even the loudest sound couldn't travel from a sender on Earth to a receiver out into the vacuum of space. The world record for the loudest shout was set in 1984 by school teacher Annalisa Flanagan. She yelled the word quiet at a volume of 121.7 decibels, the equivalent of a jet plane taking off. The loudest sound ever measured was the 1883 explosion of the island of Krakatoa. People 64 kilometers away had their eardrums ruptured. That's how loud it was. And in 2016, LIGO released the sound of two black holes colliding. However, that wasn't actual sound waves traveling through space to reach us from 1.3 billion light years away. It was gravitational waves, and the data collected was then converted through software into something we could hear. Sound traveling through space is simply impossible. No, it isn't. In the summer of 1977, the space probes Voyager 1 and Voyager 2 were launched into space. To this day, Voyager 1 is the farthest man-made object to have traveled away from Earth, at more than 20 billion kilometers. Both probes have a copy of the Voyager Golden Record on board. The contents include pictures of life on Earth, 1 hour of human brainwaves, spoken greetings in different languages, and a playlist of recorded musical selections. One of these musical selections is the wrath-filled aria Der Hölle Rache kocht in meinem Herzen, where the Queen of the Night sends off her daughter Pamina to go and stab Sarasso, her rival, who then joins forces with Tamino, who marries Pamina, who finally realizes that it wasn't Sarasso but it was the Queen of the Night who was the bad guy all along. Well, the bad girl. In any case, if or when these golden records fall into the hands of extraterrestrials, let's just hope that they don't take this particular piece to be a provocation. Lest it lead into a series of battles of intergalactic proportions. Cheers to that.